إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فقد قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما روى ذلك أبو هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه وأرضاه: سبعة يظلهم الله في ظله يوم لا ظل إلا ظله: إمام عادل، وشاب نشأ في عبادة الله تعالى، ورجل قلبه معلق في المساجد، ورجلان تحابا في الله اجتمعا عليه وتفرقا عليه، ورجل دعته امرأة ذات منصب وجمال فقال إني أخاف الله، ورجل تصدق بصدقة فأخفاها حتى لا تعلم شماله ما تنفق يمينه، ورجل ذكر الله خاليا فخافت عيناه. أحبتي في الله، this afternoon بإذن الله تعالى we want to spend some time with this great hadith found in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. Abu Hurairah رضي الله عنه وارضاه reported the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that there are seven categories of people, that is, who will be granted a shade on the day of Qiyamah when there is no shade but his shade, that is the shade of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And then he mentioned who these seven are. Amongst them he said the just ruler, and he also mentioned that young individual, that youth who grew up in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that individual whose heart is attached to the masajid or the mosques, and two individuals who love one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so their meeting and their departing is all for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And another individual, that man who is invited and who is seduced by a beautiful woman who has no fear because of the position that she has, but he rejects that seduction, he does not give in to her, but rather he says, indeed, I fear Allah. And also that individual who gives for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that individual who gives a charity and he hides it to the extent that his left hand doesn't know what his right hand has given. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also mentioned that individual who when alone remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and as a result of his remembering Allah azza wa jal, his eyes are filled with tears. This hadith is a wonderful hadith, and we want to look at some of the meanings that are contained within it, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. First and foremost, sab'atun yudhilluhumullahu fi dhillihi yawma la dhilla illa dhilluh. It is not to be understood here that only seven individuals will be granted this favor on the Day of Judgment, but rather, as we said earlier, these are seven categories of people. So in other words, everyone who fits that profile that is mentioned in the hadith, everyone who fits that profile will insha'Allah ta'ala receive that favor on the day of Qiyamah. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says Imamun Adil, it doesn't mean that only one ruler from amongst the rulers will be granted this favor on the day of Qiyamah, but rather everyone that behaved in that way. And by the way, ruler here doesn't only mean a head of state, it doesn't mean only a governor, but it also refers to every individual who is in a position of authority. As Imam Ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah said, that if a teacher were to be fair and just between two students, he is also referred to as Imamun Adil. And anyone, as we said, who fits these the profile of any of these categories that are mentioned, then inshaAllah ta'ala, they will receive that favor on the day of Qiyamah. So bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, they will be thousands and thousands of people. Now, before we continue looking at these categories of people, we need to get two or three things out of the way. The first of them is that, and of course it's a regular reminder, and it is that we are looking at this hadith, and we are looking at these categories of people for the purpose of us learning who deserves and who can earn this favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we listen to this hadith, we do not want to listen to it just to fill the time and to entertain ourselves, but we want to listen carefully so that we can be amongst those seven groups of people, so that those characteristics that are mentioned in this hadith, we will try to attain at least one of them, if not all of them, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. The second thing is, remember when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, سَبْعَةٌ يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. It is very significant for us to understand what he is saying here. Seven categories of people who will be granted a shade on the day of Qiyamah, that Allah Jalla wa Ala will keep under his shade. يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. The day there will be no shade but that of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is that day? And what is the significance of these words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The day about which he is speaking is the day of resurrection, the day of Qiyamah, the day of judgment. That day when we will all be raised before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we will have no one to protect us but Allah Jalla wa Ala. We will have nothing with us. We will not be able to hide anywhere. We will not be able to hide under anything. And why is it that we would need a shade on that day? It is because the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed us of what the situation will be like on that day. Today we look at the sun and it's very far away, although it seems very near. And at times in the summer, we feel as though we cannot tolerate it any longer. So we have to take shelter, we have to find a shade. On the day of Qiyamah, the sun will not be that far away. For as Uqba ibn Amir radiallahu anhu arba reports, he swears by Allah that he heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, تَدْمُ الشَّمْسُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ مِنَ الرُّؤُوسِ حَتَّى مَا يَكُونُ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَ النَّاسِ إِلَّا الْمِيلِ. He says radiallahu anhu arba that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that on the day of Qiyamah, on the day of judgment, the sun will be so near to one of us, the sun will be so near to everyone, that the distance between us and the sun will only be a meal. Meal is often translated as a mile. And a mile is known, it's a distance of measure. But Uqba ibn Amir radiallahu anhu arba says, because he is speaking in the Arabic language, he says, I don't know exactly what he meant by a meal, whether it be that measure of distance, or it is that stick which is used in order to apply the kuhl to the eyes. Nonetheless, the sun will be very near to each and every one of us on the day of Qiyamah. You can imagine then, try to picture yourself in that position, you can imagine then how everyone will be dying for a shelter. Everyone will be dying for a shade. There will be no umbrellas on that day. There will be no buildings that we can take shelter under. There will be no trees that we can take shade from. It will only be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can provide a shade on that particular day. That day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will descend in a manner that befits His Majesty tabaraka wa ta'ala, He will descend on His throne. While He is over His throne, again, as befits His Majesty subhanahu wa ta'ala, and eight angels carrying his throne, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on that day, it is the day of qiyamah, it is the day of judgment. This is what we have to realize. Why is it that you want to be from amongst those seven? It is because of this reason. Because the moment is a tense one. It is a difficult moment indeed. That day when you are waiting for the creator of the heavens and the earth and all that lies between them to come and judge between us. We will be waiting there. And Allah Jalla wa Ala descends as befits His Majesty on His throne with the eight angels carrying that throne. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, Ana al-Malik, Ana al-Malik, that I am the king. I am the one who is the sovereign on this day. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say that. And as we learn from the Quran, Maliki Yawmi Deen, Allahu Jalla wa Ala, He is the owner of the Day of Judgment, He is the King of all kings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we know from the Quran, will say, Limanil Mulku Al-Yawm, Limanil Mulku Al-Yawm, to whom does the kingdom belong this day? In other words, the entire kingdom. Who can claim that they own even one thing from the kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Allahu Jalla wa Ala responds to that question Himself. He says, لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَارِ, that is, it all belongs to Allah, the One, the Prevailing. In any case, when we look at this hadith, we want to be in that state of mind, remembering that day when we will need that shade. We want to understand that loving one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as mentioned in this hadith and other hadith, is a great thing. Because as a result of this love that we have for one another, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, we will be granted a shade. Because from amongst the things that Allah Jalla wa Ala will also say on that day, from that which He will call out to His slave is, أَيْنَ الْمُتَحَابُونَ بِجَلَالِي الْيَوْمَ أُظِلُّهُمْ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلِّي. Where are those who loved one another for the sake of my glory? I will grant them a shade on this day when there is no shade but the shade that I provide for them. So hopefully these matters are understood. So now we can look at those seven categories of people that have been mentioned in this hadith. سَبْعَةٌ يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. From those seven categories of people who will be granted a shade on the day of Qiyamah, when there is no shade to be had except for that one which Allah Jalla wa Ala provides, is Imamun Adil, a just ruler. And as we said earlier, by just ruler, it doesn't mean only a head of state or a governor and so on and so forth, but it refers to anyone who is in a position of authority. As the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْئُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ, that all of you are like shepherds, all of you are in positions of authority, and you will all be questioned about those who are under your authority, that is, you will be questioned on the day of Qiyamah. So an Imam al-Adil, that just ruler, or that just authority, that individual who is just and shows fairness towards all that, all those who are under his authority, yani this refers to anyone and everyone who is in a position of authority, whether it be in their home, whether it be in the school, whether it be in their workplace. It includes all of those types of individuals. Now, let's look at a few examples, because when we look at these examples, we are encouraged more to be like them. Let's look at a few examples of justice as taught in our deen. If we are to speak about people who are just and fair, will you find anyone who is more just than the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Absolutely not. So listen to some of the examples of justice that we find in our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was fair to everyone and at all times. And of course, and there is no possibility that he would show injustice towards anyone when he was receiving revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he was being guided by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. But with all of that, he was a human being and he feared that perhaps he erred. Perhaps he stepped on someone's toes, as they say. Perhaps he said something to people that would offend them, and he felt that this was a form of injustice. Perhaps he withheld wealth and property from someone and they were deserving of it. He feared this. And therefore, from the minbar, from his pulpit, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he called upon Allah Azza wa Jal, and he said, "O Allah," the meaning, of course, of the hadith, he called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying that, "O Allah, should there be anyone from these people whom I have wronged, whether it be in their wealth or their property, or whether it be in their persons, in other words, if I have cursed anyone amongst the people and I was not justified in doing so, all of these things, if I have done them, then let this injustice that I have shown them be a form of mercy upon them. Let it be a means of expiation for them, that they will have sins forgiven as a result of my doing them down." And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also turned to all of those people who were before him, and he said to them, that should there be anyone amongst you whom I have wronged, if I had said something that is incorrect, if I have said something to offend you, if I have cursed you in any way, shape, or form, if I have withheld property from you which belongs to you, then I ask of you to settle the score with me on this day, before that day when there will neither be any dirhams or any dinars. Salawatu Rabbi wa salamu alayhi. This is from the justice that we learn from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look also at that incident that took place between a cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and one of the people from amongst the Ansar. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam radiyallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda, was the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he and one of the Ansar were in an argument. They differed, you know, over something. And basically what it was, is that Az-Zubayr's land was above the land of the Ansaris. And so when the water came, where did it come first? It came first to Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, radiallahu anhu arda. So they're arguing about that stream that flows, who has more rights to it. So finally, they decided that, listen, if we cannot resolve this difference of ours, let's take it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who will judge between us. When they brought this to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then we saw something from him. And this was the habit of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, and this should be our habit as well. Many of us, unfortunately, when it comes to the rulings in our deen, in our religion, then we like to stick to the letter of the law, and we forget about the spirit of the law. Meaning that, you know, things have to be black and white, and we don't try to find resolutions first, except for the final judgment. Look at this example. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here in this situation could have judged. He could have said, listen, I'm in the position now of a judge. You have a dispute. Here are the two litigating parties. This is who has more right to the water. But he wanted to give that Ansari a break. So he said to Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, he said, listen, when the water comes, use it to irrigate your land, and then, you know, let the water go down in the stream, let it go down to your neighbor, to the Ansari. This now was very fair. The Ansari should have accepted it. But the Ansari turns around, and he turns around to whom? To the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he says, what, you're taking sides because he is your cousin? Who is he saying this to? To the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He has been entrusted by Allah Azza wa Jal to convey the revelation to the people, but they're now saying that he cannot be trusted when it comes to judge in dollars and cents, in terms of property. So upon hearing this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam decided that there is no other way except to make it black and white. Now he was going to judge by the letter of the law. So then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam judged, and he said to Az-Zubayr, when the water comes, then irrigate your land, and then allow your entire property to be filled with water until it hits the walls that are surrounding the palm trees, and then let it go down to the Ansari if anything is left. Nonetheless, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was being fair and just, and even in the last ruling, he was just, salawatu Rabbi wa salamu alayhi. And by the way, after this, when he walked away, Allah Jalla wa Ala revealed the verses, فَلَا وَرَبِّكْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ إِلَىٰ آخِرِ الْآيَاتِ. Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed those ayat in which he said, and by your Lord, they will not believe until such time that they place you as a judge between them in any of their disputes. Also, we have the example of when the Prophet ﷺ was handing out the spoils of war. When he was handing out the spoils of war, some people took more than others, but there was a hikmah, a wisdom behind it. Those who were weak in their faith and who needed something to encourage them a little bit more, the Prophet ﷺ gave them a greater portion. And those whose hearts were filled with iman, with faith, those who had strong faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so on and so forth, then the Prophet ﷺ gave them less. Not that he was being unjust, but because he realized and he knew that they would not be offended. They would not feel badly when they received less than others. The Prophet ﷺ knew this, and he continued distributing the spoils of war in that way until one man came from, you know, the middle of the desert or wherever else, and he comes and says to the Prophet ﷺ, "I'dil." He is commanding and ordering the Prophet ﷺ to be fair and to be just, as if to say that what he is doing is a form of injustice. Of course, amongst those who was there was Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu arda, and we know the language of Umar radiallahu anhu arda. He says, "Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let me make this man's head roll. Let me execute this man, for indeed he is a hypocrite." But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to him, "No, do not do so." And then he told him about what is going to happen, and that is that from the progeny of this man will emerge a people whose prayers and whose fasting and whose recitation of the Quran will be far superior to yours, that is, of even the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But they will be such a people who exit, who leave the religion, who leave Islam as the arrow shoots through its prey. In other words, it does not come back. In any case, here also we find an example of the justice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was not being unfair to anyone, but rather he dealt with everyone according to the circumstances, and he used al-hikmah or wisdom. Also, we found this example in the Khulafa al-Rashideen, the caliphs of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, we said earlier, and in this Imam Adil, the just ruler, applies to everyone who is in a position of authority. One of those examples that we have is the one of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. On one occasion, he lost his body armor or his shield. He lost it somehow, you know, and it so happens that the one who found it and picked it up was a Jew. And as Ali radiallahu anhu was, you know, walking through the city, one day he saw it was a Jew. And he grabbed a hold of him and he said, "Hey, this is my, you know, my armor. What are you doing with it? Give it back to me." And the Jew denied it. He said, "No, it's mine. It's not yours. What proof do you have?" So he said, "But you know, I'm the Khalifa. I'm the head of state. I'm the leader of the believers." He said, "So what? You still have to bring proof." Mind you, Ali radiallahu anhu was the head of state. He could have done anything that he wanted. He could have called in the police and he could have taken it forcefully. But he didn't do so. He said, "All right, let's go for judgment." So they went to Shuraih al-Qadi, who was one of the judges at that time. They went before him now as two litigating parties, two opponents. There's a plaintiff and there's a defendant. They walk in, and Shuraih al-Qadi starts to honor Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. He says, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen." He says, "Don't call me that. I am not standing here before you today as the head of state. I am here as one of the two litigating parties. I am a plaintiff." The Qadi stepped down and wanted Ali radiallahu anhu to sit on his seat. He said, "No, you cannot treat me that way today. Today there has to be fairness and justice. I'm standing before you today as one of two parties that have a dispute. You have to judge between us. You have to treat us fairly. You have to make me sit with him." So Ali radiallahu anhu arda sat on the ground next to the Jew. And they brought the case before this judge. So the judge asks Ali, "What kind of proof do you have?" And Ali radiallahu anhu arda says, "Yes, I have proof. I have a witness. Who's your witness? He says, Al-Hasan, my son. So the judge says, but don't you know that an individual's son cannot be a witness on his behalf? Of course, Ali radiallahu anhu knew this, but he's testing the judge. So he says, in that case, I don't have any proof. Shurayh, the judge then, passed a judgment in the favor of whom? In the favor of the Jew. Because Ali radiallahu anhu warda has no evidence, he has no proof that this is his armor. So the Jew takes the armor and he starts to walk away, and then he turns around and he says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. Because he was amazed at what happened, he says, now I have believed in this deen, I have believed in this religion that made you sit next to me in this particular gathering. And then he said, I swear by Allah, this is your armor, and he gave it back to Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. This is what we call true justice. Then look at what happened with Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. He was sitting with a group of his companions, and three youth came dragging a man with them. So he says, what's the matter with you? What's with this man? And they said that this man killed our father. So they want justice. He asks the man, did you kill their father? He says, yes, I did. Basically what happened was that this man took his camel out to graze, and they started grazing in the property of that man. And the man took a stone and threw it at him, and it hit his head, and he died. So he killed their father, and he admitted that he had done this. When Umar radiallahu anhu wa asked him, he said, yes, I did it. You see, I took that stone and I threw it at him, thinking that I was scaring him off, thinking that by this I would be able to get him off my property. But it hit him on his head, and he died as a result of it. So the ruling came that a life for a life. This is the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your life has to be taken, execution for this man. Then the man pleaded. He said, give me 3 days. Please give me 3 days, because my family is out in the middle of the desert. My wife, my children, my daughters, they have no one after Allah Azza wa Jalla but me. They are dependent upon me. And when this incident took place, I didn't have the opportunity to inform them. These young men dragged me towards you. So Umar radiallahu anhu, although he was a human being and he wanted to help this individual, except that the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is superior and it is above everything. Umar radiallahu anhu is that man who said that if my flesh had to be separated from my bones, I would do so. If that's what it meant, I would do so while upholding a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Under all circumstances, the law of Allah azza wa jal is what comes above everything else. This man is pleading. Imagine that family who is dependent upon him, and so on and so forth. So then Umar radiallahu anhu says, okay, only if you can find me a guarantor who can guarantee on your behalf that you will come back. He looks around and he finds no one. He looks at the companions that are sitting there. He doesn't know anyone amongst them. He looks at them until he sees this young man, Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu warda, that righteous man whose face was glowing and shining. So he looks at him and he says, young man, I don't know you. I don't know you, but these are my circumstances. Will you not be my guarantor? So Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu says, and who is between me and you? In other words, you bring me this promise, but who is between us that would uphold this promise? And he says, Allah. At this, the eyes of Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu filled with tears, and he said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, O Umar, I'm going to be his guarantor. He said, you're going to be his guarantor? He said, yes. In the days of ignorance, pre-Islamic days of ignorance, I would have been his guarantor. But now when he comes to me with a promise and he places Allah Azza wa Jalla as the witness, how can I turn him down? For indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best of allies. If he has said that Allah is between us, then I will take his word for it. So the man goes, and 3 days pass, and on the fourth day, what happens? He is supposed to be back, but there is no sign of the man. Have you seen the man? Oh, Abu Dharr, where is he? He's nowhere to be seen. People are looking around, they cannot find him. So Umar radiallahu anhu says, the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that you will be executed in his place. What do you mean, me? I didn't do anything, but you stand it as guarantor for him. So it is your life instead of his. In any case, just before sunset, all of a sudden this man comes running. And he comes to them and he says, that wallahi, I haven't eaten all day from this morning because I wanted to make it back on time. I left my children crying and so on and so forth, but still I had to be back here because of the promise that I had given you. Upon seeing this, of course, everybody was affected emotionally. But Umar radiallahu anhu, his hands are tied. The law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that this man has to be executed. But when everybody witnessed this, then those three youth, the children of that man who died, they said that we forgive him. If he was so honest, if he was so truthful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he stuck to his word, then who are we now to not overlook this fault of his? So Umar radiallahu anhu made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he forgive these youth as they forgave this man, that he forgive them on the day of Qiyamah. And he thanked this man for being true to his word. And he, radiallahu anhu arda, thanked Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu for standing as guarantor solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In any case, here are some examples that we have of someone who is absolutely just. Now, it is for you and I to take that example into our lives. That no matter who we deal with our children, whomever we are dealing with, we have to be fair and we have to be just. As we said, even an individual who is a teacher should be just between and fair with his students when marking the exams, the way he treats them in the classroom. The one who is working, you do not favor some people who come to you as opposed to others. You have to show fairness to everyone. This is one of the ways that you can attain that shade on the day of Qiyamah, when there is no shade but that shade that is provided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَشَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. Another one of those seven is that young man, that youth, who grows up in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and as Al-Ghazali rahimahullah says, they are rare indeed. And it is rare to find those who from a young age never disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many youth do you and I know of who know nothing but the remembrance of Allah azza wa jal, who know nothing but the Qur'an, who know nothing but the masjid? How many of us know youth like this? They are very few indeed. We are not saying that they don't exist, but they are rare indeed. And we beg of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you and I can be of those who raise such youth, especially in this day and age. And as I've said on many other occasions, أَحِبَّتِ فِي اللَّهِ, let it not be your major concern to put out lawyers and accountants and doctors and other professionals. The first thing that should be in our minds when we are raising our children is to raise children who will grow up in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ. A young individual who grows up only knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not disobeying him. So that you will be of those. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah azza wa jal is amazed at that youth, at that young person. He is amazed and impressed by that young person who does not disobey him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is also reported that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he is shy to punish the youth in Islam. So where are the youth who are not shy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Let me give you an example of one or two such youth. Youth who grew up in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of them was Ayyub ibn Tamima al-Sikhtiyani. This young man, when he was only 20 years old, because he was so obedient towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he walked into the marketplace, and the people would see him, they could see the nur in his face. They could see the glow of Iman, of faith in his face. The people would drop their goods and they would be reminded of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When they saw him, they left everything and said, La ilaha illallah. Al-Hasan al-Basri alayhi rahmatullah says, every time that I saw this young man, I would say he is from the best of the youth of Basra. And I think, inshallah, he is from the people of Jannah. Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas, Imam Dar al-Hijra, rahmatullah ta'ala alayhi, says that I thought that there is no good in the people of Iraq until I saw Ayyub when he came to visit us in Medina, and he came to the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he made salam, he greeted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at his grave, and when he did so, he cried so much that I thought his ribs were going to interlock with one another. A youth who grows up in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet another one of those youths, Sahal ibn Abdullah al-Tashturi. He used to sit with his ustad, with his teacher, with his sheikh, reciting the Quran. And his teacher loved him more than any of the other students. So those students went to their parents and they complained that, listen, he favors Sahal over us. So of course, the parents go to the teacher and say, why is it that you favor Sahal over the other students? He says, because he fears Allah more than your kids. He says, that's a pretty big statement. You have to show me proof of that. He says, yes, I have the evidence. He was wise. And he was a very wise man. So what he did in this situation, he said to his students that I want that tomorrow when all of you come to class, you bring a chicken with you. So they all came the next day with a chicken. And he said to them, now, I want all of you to go out and find a place where you can slaughter that chicken, but find a place where no one sees you. So they all went, and they all slaughtered the chicken except for Sahal. They come back, and all of them are asked, so did you slaughter your chickens? They said, yes. Sahal, how come you didn't slaughter yours? He says, because you told us we should find such a place where we can slaughter these chickens where no one sees us. And I found a place that was isolated and secluded, but then I remembered that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees me wherever I am, and so I didn't slaughter the chicken. So this was the proof that he fears Allah more than anyone else. شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. My goal as well as yours as a parent should be what? To raise such youth who love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and who will do anything to stay away from the disobedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. But we have to provide them with that environment. So parents, from a young age, the goals that you set for your children, number one on the list is not that they are going to have a PhD, but rather that they will grow up in the worship of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Amongst the seven categories, رَجُلَانِ تَحَابَّا فِي اللَّهِ اجْتَمَعَا عَلَيْهِ وَتَفَرَّقَا عَلَيْهِ. Two individuals who love one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What brought them together in the first place was the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we make friends, what are our friendships based upon? When you make a friend at school, why do you befriend that individual? Because he or she is popular? Not a good reason. When you befriend another individual and you show love towards them and you honor them, why? Because they have a good position somewhere in the government and perhaps they can get you a good job? Not a good reason. We should love another individual because of their love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. تحابا في الله. They love one another for the sake of Allah azza wa jal. And when one of them travels and one of them dies, yes, at the end of the day, they still have love towards one another because of their love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this example. You know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to establish bonds of brotherhood between his companions. Salman radiallahu anhu wa ba, his partner, his brother, and he had two, and one of them was Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, and the other one was Abdullah ibn Salam, who used to be a Jew and then he entered into Islam. So these two individuals loved one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now those who love one another for the sake of Allah, they will advise one another always with those things that will draw them closer to Allah. A good friend is not the one who helps you commit a sin. A good friend is not the one who, when you speak in front of him, you know, things that make no sense, or when you are lewd in front of him, he laughs at you. Or he laughs with you, I should say. But rather, he will rebuke you and remind you of Allah Azza wa Jal. A good friend is one who always reminds you of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala and your duties towards him. That is a good friend. Not the one who, you know, overlooks the fact that you don't pray and says, no, you're a good person because you have a clean heart, even though you don't pray. No. A good friend is the one who will advise you to be dutiful towards Allah, to be dutiful towards your parents, etc., etc. In any case, Abdullah ibn Salam says to Salman radiallahu anhuma, he says to him, listen, you know, even after we die, this relationship has to continue. So if I die before you or you die before me, make sure that if one of, you know, if I come to your dream, if I die before you and I come to you in your dream, then make sure, or at least if you die before me and you come and you come to my dream, then make sure that you advise me of something good that would draw me closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because, by the way, I mean, this is another topic altogether, the belief of Ahlul Sunnah wa Jama'ah is that the souls, after they depart, after we leave this world, in al-hayat al-barzakhiyya, in that life between this one and the resurrection, the souls do visit one another. The souls do visit one another. So he says,